I'm sorry. The mitochondria was coined by C. Benba. Okay, so this term mitochondria was coined by C. Benda. This mitochondria is also known as powerhouse of the cell. Powerhouse of the cell, because this mitochondria has the major function of producing ATP, hence it is known as powerhouse of the cell. And also there is another name for this mitochondria, that is energy transforming organelle. Energy transforming organelle. So this mitochondria is also known as energy transforming organelle. Next, the major function of mitochondria. What all are the major function of mitochondria, or where these mitochondria is involved? The first and the major function is ATP synthesis. Okay, ATP production or ATP synthesis. The next thing you can see is this mitochondria is involved in several signaling pathways. For example, this mitochondria is involved in programmed cell death. Okay, programmed cell death. And also, if you are looking into signaling process of calcium, where you can see the mitochondria is also involved in this calcium signaling. Okay, calcium signaling. Then the next thing is about the biosynthesis of heme. So this mitochondria is also involved in the biosynthesis of heme. Then the other thing is the beta oxidation, or the fatty acid oxidation of fatty acid. Okay, so this mitochondria is also involved in the oxidation of fatty acid. The last but not the least is the this mitochondria is also involved in the signal transduction in the immune responses. Okay, this is also involved in the signal transduction. Okay, signal transduction in the innate immune response. Okay, innate immune response. So this is all about the function of mitochondria. Now we can discuss about the structure of mitochondria. So if you are preparing for CSI UGC NET examination, don't miss the video. Okay, so this is the part one video, and the part two will consist of the protein transport across the mitochondria. Okay, so first you need the basics about mitochondria, then only you can understand the protein transport across the mitochondria. So please watch the part one and part two video. So next thing is about the structure of mitochondria. Okay, now we are going to discuss about the structure. So here you can see in this structure there is two membranes, so that we can say that our mitochondria is have a double membraneous structure. Okay, double membrane structure. And this outer membrane is known as outer mitochondrial membrane, and this inner membrane is known as inner mitochondrial membrane. So it has an outer mitochondrial membrane as well as an inner mitochondrial membrane, and there you can also see some space is there in between this outer mitochondrial membrane and inner mitochondrial membrane, where you can see that this space is known as inner membranous space. Okay, and here if you look carefully into the mitochondrial structure, you can definitely see that the inner mitochondrial membrane is folded too many times, isn't it? Definitely there is so many foldings, and this folding is known as Christie. Okay, this folding is known as Christie. So don't confuse this term Christie with the cisternae in Golgi apparatus. In the Golgi apparatus, we already studied that there are some sac-like structures in the Golgi, when we studied about cis Golgi, trans Golgi, everything, and this structure is known as cisternae. Okay, cisternae, and don't confuse the cisternae with Christie. Okay, in mitochondria, the folding is known as Christie, and this folding increases the surface area. So, okay, each folding increase the surface area. This is the major function why this inner membrane is folded too many times, which will increase the surface area. And the innermost portion of this mitochondria is known as matrix. This is matrix, okay? And this membrane has two sides. The one side is which is facing into the matrix is known as matrix side, okay? Or you can also say inside. And the membrane which is facing to the cytosolic side is known as P side. Okay, the membrane which is facing to the cytosol is known as P side, and the membrane which is facing to the matrix is known as N side. Okay, so in membrane has two sides. One is facing to the matrix and is known as N side or matrix side. The other one is cytosolic side or otherwise known as P side. And in this matrix, you can also see ATP synthesis. Okay, we already said that the major function of the mitochondria is ATP synthesis, so that you can also see ATP synthase in the mitochondria. Mainly you can see this in the F0 F1 compartment, okay, which produce ATP. And also you can see some channels, okay, channels which helps in the protein transport, and the and this channel is known as mitochondrial porins, okay, and this channel is known as mitochondrial porins. And also you just remember that this mitochondrial membrane is strictly prohibited, okay. They will only allow selected proteins to enter into the mitochondria. They will not allow any molecules to pass through, because this membrane is too much impermeable. As this membrane is synthesized with, membrane is rich in phospholipid, okay, rich in phospholipid. Hence the phospholipid component or phospholipid portion of this membrane is high, and so that it will become impermeable to molecules, okay, impermeable to molecules. And the major phospholipid which are present in high is known as cardiolipin, okay. Cardiolipin is the major phospholipid present in the outer membrane, okay. That is why the membrane is impermeable to molecules. So this mitochondrial porins which helps in transporting proteins across the membrane. And we can say this voltage, they are voltage gated selective channels. Voltage gated selective channels. These are voltage gated selective channels. Only in the presence of voltage differences, that is if the voltage is low to zero, then the voltage gated channel opens. If the voltage is positive or high, then it get closed, okay. So it had two conformation, open conformation and a closed conformation, and it is very very selective. The proteins which have signal, okay, which have a signal or which is designated to mitochondria, only enter into mitochondria. No other protein can enter into mitochondria. Now looking into the matrix, what all are the things you can see inside the matrix? In the matrix you can see a double stranded DNA, okay, rather than the nuclear DNA. In mitochondria it has its own DNA which is circular, mostly circular in shape, okay. It has its own DNA. This mitochondria is self-replicating, self-replication, okay, self-replicating through binary fission, The next thing you can see is the ribosome. Like the bacterial ribosomes, the mitochondrial ribosomes also ranges in between 55 to 75S, okay. These are all the things which you can see in the mitochondrial matrix. Okay, so for this reason, as it has the dsDNA and self-replicating, and it has ribosomes, so it can produce its own proteins, okay. so that we can say this organelle is semi-autonomous. Okay, semi-autonomous organelle. Okay, because they have their own genetic material. Now we are going to discuss about some endosymbiotic theory. Okay, we are going to discuss about endosymbiotic hypothesis. What is endosymbiotic hypothesis? So today we are going to discuss about endosymbiotic hypothesis. Actually, this is proposed in 1970 by Lynn Margulis. Okay, Lynn Margulis proposed this theory. Okay, they said that this primitive, the when life originated, this mitochondria was an organism. Okay, it's actually an organism, is unicellular organism. Due to some accidental exposure to the eukaryotes or through engulfing processes or anything, this mitochondria has been a part of eukaryote. Okay, by words we cannot say that. We need evidences to prove this is true. Okay, so that if we are comparing bacteria and mitochondria, you will get some evidences which support this endosymbiotic hypothesis. In the first thing is the mitochondria is self-replicating. It has its own dsDNA so that it can replicate it on its own. As already we have said that they will replicate by binary fission. Okay, like bacteria, the one cell get divided into two. Same like that in mitochondria also, this mitochondria divides by binary fission. The next thing is this mitochondria has its own dsDNA. Like bacteria, they also has a circular dsDNA like that. Same like that, this mitochondria also has dsDNA, which is circular in shape. The next thing is about the ribosome and some enzyme. Okay, ribosomes and some enzymes transport proteins. Okay, enzymes and some transport proteins which are very much similar to the bacteria. Okay, now if we discuss more about the size of the mitochondria, it's approximately same size as that of bacteria. Then if you look about a protein synthesis in mitochondria is inhibited by certain antibiotics. Okay, protein inside mitochondria is inhibited by certain antibiotics which also inhibit bacterial proteins for example chloramphenicol, then erythromycin, then tetracycline, etc. These all antibiotics also inhibit the proteins inside the mitochondria as well as the protein in the bacteria. So by this all things we can say that this mitochondria has endosymbiotic nature, that is, it is evolved inside, or no, it is not generated by the cell, it is adapted into the cell. Okay, the next thing about a mitochondria is the inheritance. How this mitochondria is inherited to the daughter cells. Okay, inherited to the daughter cell. How it is inherited? I already said that mitochondria divides into two. Okay, so that it is not synthesized any of the parent. Okay, either female parent or male parent should donate the mitochondria to the offspring. Usually the female parent donates the cytoplasm, okay, donate the cytoplasm to the offspring, in which the cytoplasm also consists of mitochondria. So the offspring will get mitochondria also. Okay, so in this type of inheritance is known as uniparental. Okay, uniparental, only one of the parent will donate mitochondria to the offspring. But in some lower eukaryote, okay, lower eukaryotes like yeast, okay, like yeast, here both the parents, male as well as female parent, okay, both the parent will donate mitochondria to the offspring. Okay, so such condition we can call it as biparental. From both the parent it get the mitochondria. And the next thing about mitochondria, this is all about mitochondria, and we have one more topic remaining, that is some mitochondrion related organelles. Okay, there are two organelles we are going to discuss about, that hydrogenosomes, okay, hydrogenosomes and mitosomes. We are going to discuss about this organelles. These hydrogenosomes are seen in certain protists. Okay, they are seen in some protists where they lack mitochondria. They have no mitochondria. Okay, no mitochondria. Where they lack mitochondria, they need another organelle which do the same function of mitochondria. So they have hydrogenosomes. They have hydrogenosomes. This hydrogenosome, through pyruvate fermentation, okay, pyruvate fermentation, they will produce ATP and hydrogen. Okay, they will produce ATP and hydrogen. So this hydrogenosomes are the site of pyruvate fermentation. So this process is coupled with ATP production through substrate level phosphorylation. Okay, substrate level phosphorylation. Substrate level phosphorylation. Okay, so now we are going to discuss about the mitosomes. So in mitosomes, okay, mitosome, there is no production of ATP. Okay, in this is the mitosome is something which is originated from mitochondria, so it has double membranous structure like mitochondria, but it's actually a reduced form of hydrogenosomes. Reduced form of hydrogenosomes. As it is the reduced form of hydrogenosomes, it will not generate, okay, will not generate ATP. Will not generate ATP. So, example is some parasitic unicellular eukaryotic parasites like Entamoeba, okay, Entamoeba and Giardia. Giardia are some of the examples of parasites, unicellular eukaryotic parasites, which have this mitosome as a mitochondrion like organelle. So today we are stopping this class because now our video is too lengthy. So in the part 2 video, we will discuss about the protein targeting into the mitochondria. So we can meet in next class. Until then, bye. Okay.